fantasy actually had to do with cosmology. It was to do with inflationary cosmology, because I simply thought inflation is much too fantastic. That's another story. But the fashion, so I had to write this new preface. They're going to bring it out. It's out now. I think it's almost out now. A new printing of Fashion Faith. I wasn't allowed to change anything in the book, but I was allowed to write a new preface. And I do give an outline of this idea. I think I do. The retrocausal thing. You see, the thing is, think about the standard EPR. So you have a spin zero state, splits into two halves, spin half, and Alice takes one off in a spaceship and Bob takes it up on another half. Alice makes a measurement. What do I say happens to the quantum reality? It's a quantum measurement. Quantum reality propagates along the path like cone. What could be crazier than that? The backwards way, along the path like cone. It hits Bob's world line way earlier than he does his experiment. So his state is already changed into the one which is the opposite of Alice's state. Bob makes his measurement later. He doesn't know what the state is. Alice can only communicate classically with him. This is a quantum information. Now, quantum reality information. Quantum reality, you cannot measure, you can only ascertain.
Explain the difference between ascertaining and confirming. Because when you were on stage with Sabine Hossenfelder, you said, you can confirm at, I think it was the classical level, you can confirm.
And you can confirm.
Whereas at the quantum, you can ascertain. Like you can ask a question.
That's right. Well, you see, it's really Einstein. It's Einstein's fault. Because he was saying, I think a lot of people were worrying about the reality of the wave function.
Mm-hmm.
Is it real? Is it really there? Not real. It's complex, you see. It's not real in the sense of real numbers. But is it really there? And Einstein produced the statement. He said, well, a concept of reality is introducing, which is if there's a measurement you can make on the system without disturbing it, and which with 100% certainty gives the answer yes, then that measurement is revealing an element of reality. So he says that the state, the quantum state, is real in that sense. What he didn't say, as far as I'm aware, is that it's quantum reality. It's not classical reality. Think of the spin of a spin half particle. I always like spin half particles.
Sure.
It's the simplest thing to say. Spin up and spin down, if you like, or spin right and spin left. Suppose its spin is about that way. If I know through its origin, where did that spin come from? Oh, yes, I know. Oh, it should be spinning that way.
Wait, sorry, is this a hidden variable that it's carrying
it? It's not hidden variables. Forget about Bohm. I had endless arguments with Basil Hiley on that topic, and I prefer not to go back there when I was at Birkbeck College.
All right.
Let's not talk about hidden variables. If you can call them hidden variables, you can, but that's not my idea. It's not that.
Got it.
It's quantum reality. So the state is that, but it has a quantum reality of spinning right-handed about that particular direction.
Mm-hmm.
And we know it is because we've set up and we've produced it in that state. You could do that by some experiment, and it comes out in that state. Now, I'm going to use Einstein's criterion. I can measure the spin in that direction using, as long as it's got a magnetic dipole or something, I can measure it, and I can, if I've got it right, every time I measure it, I can measure the same experiment many times over. 100% certainty, that's real. That's what Einstein said is his element of reality. I'm just slightly modifying what he said. It's an element of quantum reality. It's not classical reality. I can't say to the state, hello, state, which way are you pointing? Just looks at you blankly. It says, I don't answer questions like that. Give me a better question, you see. If I say, are you spinning that way? It can say no or yes. If you say, which way are you spinning? It doesn't answer that question. That's a quantum reality thing. Quantum reality you can't ascertain it. That's the one I say you can't ascertain. You can't ascertain which way it's spinning. However, you can confirm which way it's spinning by the Einstein criteria.
I see.
Now, if Alice and Bob, you see, if Alice propagates back in time, Bob's state is already, in a certain sense, the opposite of what Alice is going to measure. But Bob can't ask the state, which way are you spinning? If he could, then you could, obviously, you could send signals faster than light. The whole of special relativity goes down the tubes. The whole of modern physics does. So that's not a good idea. So quantum reality, sure. Bob can't say, he can ask it. His spinning state says, don't ask me such a question. I don't answer questions like that. Suggests a direction. So he does. He suggests a different direction. He has no idea what Alice has spun. I did worry about this quite a lot by saying, can he ascertain which way Alice is measuring it, and even if you don't know which answer she gets? So there's a bit of a subtlety there, because she might orient her apparatus in some way, and does that information somehow, you want to make sure that can't be ascertained by Bob either.
Uh-huh. That she's free to choose independently?
She's free to choose. She says, yeah. Well, she might say, oh, I think I'm going to choose that direction because that Bob's keen on that direction or something, and that will tell me I'm happy. See, no, she can't do that.
Have you thought about free will?
I've thought about it. In fact, I thought about it even quite recently. First of all, I think it's a useless kind of thought because even though, you see, Stuart is very keen on free will because he says that the theory of microtubules and all that stuff gives a room for free will. See, maybe it does in a way, but you see, often people say, well, it's all determined anyway. So I think people get a little bit confused. You see, I going back to my experiences I used to have when I was very young, and my younger brother was even younger, and he could always wallop me at this game, scissors, paper, stone. And I thought, how can he be walloping that game of chance?
Right.
So to make sure it was a game of chance that he couldn't wallop me at, I went into my father's study and I got out a book of logarithms and went into the middle of it and got out the string of numbers and produced which way you went by the string of numbers, followed it very carefully, and he couldn't beat me. So I thought, thank goodness. He's not reading my mind. It's just that he knows, gets recognizing patterns and things like that. He's good at that. Maybe even unconsciously. He recognizes these patterns and he knows which way I'm going to do next because I'm not really being random. So it's not randomness.
Yes.
The free will is not randomness. So what is it? You see, I think it's probably, you're free to do something which may be very well determined. You see, do I take course A? Or course B. You may be in some meeting, you see, which making decisions about some big plan. And you want to know, what is the consequence of doing A or B? Well, then you rely on your understanding of which is the right thing to do. So free will, it might be the same as somebody would do just by chance. That's not the point. The point is that you've used your consciousness as something to employ in making your decision. So that's what free will is for, in a sense. I don't know if I can say much more. And I also get impressed by things when I hear things about bees, and they're unbelievable.
Yeah.
And they seem to play...
They're unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Yes, well, they play football. There's some thing they were telling me about. They're not trying to hunt for honey. They do things in little balls and they kick them around. There's some kind of football that they play. Why are they doing that? For fun? That would mean they have to be conscious, doesn't it? Maybe they are. I don't know. I don't have a view on this. I do believe that consciousness goes way down in the animal kingdom, sure.
Is the universe discrete or continuous?
I used to be very keen on discrete. I did it. Yes. People told me, I got to go into anecdotes. I'm too old. I just talk about anecdotes rather than the physics.
Okay.
If you want an anecdote, I can give you an anecdote. I used to be very keen on discreteness. There were two things in mathematics that I thought, oh, these are the nice things for physics ultimately to be based on. Combinatorial things or maybe complex numbers. And I think I sort of at that time thought combinatorial things.
I'm surprised if you came from algebraic geometry that you would be more keen to the finite side, the discrete side.
I probably was at that time. You see, I had a sort of gradual conversion. I think the conversion came with David Finkelstein. When, as he said after his talk, he gave this talk that Dennis Sharma took me to when I was a research fellow at St. John's in Cambridge. And we drove to London to hear this lecture given by David Finkelstein, which was on the Schwarzschild horizon, which is not a singularity, is a horizon.
Sure.
And he described that. And I found that amazing. I thought it very beautiful. At the end of the talk, I had a long chat with him about spin networks. So I described the spin networks to him. And he told me afterwards that this meeting, we swapped subjects. I did general relativity from then on, and he had been doing GR. He swapped onto combinatorics. I consider I got much the better deal. But that's, you see, I was thinking about combinatorial things, and spin networks were very much that kind of thing. Can you not think about the complex numbers which give you the directions of spin for a spin half particle, or do you instead think about this network, which is really the important thing, and the direction comes out of the network? No, that was, I was playing with that idea.
You said you've changed your tune now to be on the more continuous side or continuum side.
The power of complex analysis was the other thing which had impressed me. And it's more drifted onto that side.
Do you think the continuous lies at the classical level and then the discreteness lies at the quantum one? Do you think that's the way to quote unquote unify them or harmonize them?
I wouldn't say anything like that as... I mean, maybe. Obviously there's something discrete in quantum mechanics. I mean, something which people used to think was continuous, shock, shock, is actually discrete.
Now, speaking of what people used to think, you used to think that AI couldn't do what mathematicians do. Do you still hold that view because of their limitations, their formal systems?
In a certain sense, yes. I mean, you've got to be a little careful about these things. But I was hearing just recently, I think it was on Zoom talk.
Yeah, the remarkable 0-1 model or 0-1 model of ChatGPT, yeah. What would be an example of something mathematical that you think a computer could never do this?
Well, it doesn't do anything. You see, you've got to tell him.
Well, even if you put it on play, you just press play and you say, generate for me some math. Because if it's the autoplay, that's the issue here. That's easily solvable.
I mean, there's a confusion, I think. I mean, it's also important to me. See, because one of the talks that I attended when I was a graduate student at Cambridge, nothing to do with what I was doing, was a talk by a man called Steen on mathematical logic. And I learned about notion of computability. I learned about the Gödel theorem. I found it stunning. Because what it told me, you want to prove something in mathematics? How is this statement? What the Gödel theorem says, it says, I am not provable by your methods. Yet I know it's true. Why do I know it's true? I know it's true by virtue of my belief that the proof procedures only give you truths.
There is the idea that people can brain upload. That is, they can take your consciousness and put it onto a computer?
No.
What are your views on that?
No, I'm saying no on that one, definitely. If a computer, when you say the word computer, you have to be saying what I mean by a computer and what Turing meant by a computer, which is a computational system. So if it's that, no is the answer.
Hmm.
If you're talking about a physical entity, which is not an animal or not a living being in our ordinary sense of the word, maybe. But it has to take advantage of what we're taking advantage of without even worrying about it, which is presumably, and here I'm going way outside of what I know, but I'm saying it's whatever the physics is which governs the collapse of the wave function.
Right.
Now, that is not quantum physics, because quantum physics doesn't have an answer to that question. It's this physics which combines GR with quantum mechanics. Maybe it used multi-twisters for all I know. I have no idea. It would be very nice if it does.
Do you think if quantum theory was not to be modified, then the many worlds interpretation is the way to go?
It would just be wrong. I'd say it can be any way. People believe in, stick to quantum mechanics, that wrong theory, then they would have to go that way. But I don't want to go that way because I want to go the way that the world goes.
Oh, what I mean to say is, do you think quantum theory as it stands implies the many worlds theory?
Problem with quantum mechanics doesn't say anything about the many worlds theory. Yeah, I mean, in a sense, yes, because it says all these things are in superposition. But I'm not quite sure what the many worlds theory is, because it can't be just that. Otherwise, I wouldn't see just one world. So what is the rest of the theory, which tells me that I only see a limited proportion that may be there in superposition, but not many? Certainly not as different as they could be. I don't see all these alternatives. Now, is that to do with this little creature crawling through this multitude? Now, why doesn't this creature going off in another branch? It doesn't explain anything.
Recently,
I'm just saying it's wrong. You're trying to say, if I believed in quantum mechanics, yes, but then I can believe in a wrong thing and I get another wrong answer.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into my, into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.